This is another video on waves. This is what we're covering here. In this video, we're going to be talking about these specific properties that all waves share, whether they're transverse or longitudinal or mechanical or electromagnetic. So we know that any particle in a wave exists in simple harmonic motion. We can imagine this wave moving through a red string as an example. The blue particle on the string is moved up and down in simple harmonic motion by the wave as the wave moves through it. Like other forms of simple harmonic motion, a wave has an amplitude, period, and frequency. So we're going to start by talking about the amplitude of this wave. So I'm going to start this wave moving and then begin to talk. So you'll remember in simple harmonic motion that the amplitude is the maximum displacement from the center that the object achieves. So you can see that these green lines here each show the amplitude that the particle has achieved from the center point. So just like in simple harmonic motion, where we say that the amplitude is measured from the equilibrium position, the center, to the extreme, we also say that for waves. So this length in particular is the amplitude of this wave. It's the displacement from the center of the wave. Waves can also have a period and frequency. Just a reminder that a period is the amount of time it takes something to complete one complete cycle. So here, if I start this clock and observe how long it takes this particle to complete one full oscillation. I can see that it took 6 seconds. So that means that the period of this wave is 6 seconds. So the period of a wave tells you how long any one particle within a wave takes to complete one full cycle of the wave. And the frequency, as you know, is just 1/period. So in this case, that would be equal to 0.167 hertz or 0.167 repetitions per second. So the frequency of the wave just tells you how often the wave repeats in 1 second. This is some arbitrary but important vocabulary. We call the highest point of a wave the crest of a wave and the lowest point the trough of a wave. So these are crests and troughs of a single wave. All waves also have a wavelength, the length of one complete wave pattern. The variable that we use for wavelength is the Greek letter lambda. It looks kind of like an upside down Y, and the unit is meters or M. So one full repetition of a wave looks like this, like one complete sine wave like this. So the horizontal length of this wave is going to be equal to the wavelength of the wave. That's what we mean when we talk about the wavelength. The wavelength can be measured as the length between two consecutive crests or two consecutive troughs of a wave. So you'll notice that here, by measuring between two consecutive troughs, I can also find the exact wavelength of the wave. That's the same length as what I measured before. And it's the same up here if I measure between two crests of the wave. A common mistake is for students to only identify the length of half the wave as the full wave. They'll see like, oh, this looks like a complete pattern, so this must be the wavelength, but that's actually only half the wavelength. Longitudinal waves have areas of compression and areas of rarefaction. These correspond to the crests and troughs of the wave. The length between two points of compression or two points of rarefaction is the wavelength. So this is what I mean by compression and rarefaction, where the wave is stretching out the matter versus where it's compressing the matter. So the wavelength is the distance between any two of those points, either two consecutive points of compression or two consecutive points of rarefaction. And that's what you need to know about the basic physical properties of a wave.